So, welcome to all of you for our OTS. So, today's speaker is Vishak Gupta-Gayan. So, just to introduce briefly, he did his BTech from Jadavpur University, then a master's from JNC, Jawaharlal Nehru Center, and then PhD from UCSD, US. After that, he moved to Australia to ANU. And after that, he became a faculty at Melbourne, University of Melbourne. And after that, he has a joint appointment with ISC, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, and Melbourne right now. So he's giving his talk right now from Melbourne. Okay. So Vishak has many interests. I've seen his work in stratified flows, oceanic flows. Today, he's going to talk about some convection work. Okay, so Vishak, it's great to have you, and please start your seminar.
Thanks, Mahendra, and thanks for a great introduction. So before we had that delay, so let's start the topic. So today I'm going to talk about the role of turbulence and convection in driving geostrophic gyre and overturning circulation. Yes, this is a lot of jargons in terms of oceanographic application. So over this talk, I'll explain what I mean by gyre and overturning circulation for oceanic system. This work has been done with my colleagues and also my PhD student. And these are the list here, and these are the complete list. There's so many other papers out there, but these are the key people. Like I mainly did collaboration during this work. So now this is a very nice visualization from NASA Visual Lab. Is actually get the data from satellite, and then some reanalysis has been done. What is it showing here? It is showing the surface current and surface eddy. So everything is in the surface. So if I play this movie, so we have three big ocean. So this is your Atlantic Ocean, okay, and then is Indian Ocean, and then Pacific Ocean. You can see here there's a lot of currents going on, and then particularly if you look at very carefully, any ocean basin, there is a called intensification happen in the western boundary. So you can see here, this is called western boundary currents, okay, which is along the western side of the US. Then there is a western current also happen along the side of the Brazil, and then Agulhas Current along the Africa, and then also through the Japan, okay, Kuroshia. So these are the biggest current you can see in the world ocean. And this current actually form a gyre circulation. When you mean gyre, that means this current is actually coming back and forming big, you can think about as the biggest eddy, okay, which is the size of the ocean basin. These are called as a gyre. So they are mainly happen over the surface of the ocean. They are very important because these gyres actually, or this current actually takes the heat from the equator and moves to the polar environment. Okay. So they control the heat transfer, mass transfer, and of course, they connect with the atmosphere. They connect with the atmosphere. So it's in terms of they have a big impact on the climate. And another thing in here, which is, I think I play the movie again. So here, the color shows the temperature, surface temperature. So you can clearly see is the equator is the most warmer part of the ocean. And more and more you go to the pole, both sides, not exactly symmetric, but both sides, you get a cooler temperature. This is what we call sea surface temperature or SST. So now, this is I'm showing more like a surface flow. Okay. Now, this is what we call as a gyre, but now then next time is called overturning. So what do you mean by overturning? This is, I'm talking about horizontal flow. Now, when I'm looking further, we have to think about the vertical motion, because ocean is not a two-dimensional system. Ocean is the three-dimensional system. So just to show further, or you might get a taste of this sea surface temperature, but this is more clear here. So equator is the warmer part of the ocean, and then towards the pole, it is the cold. Okay? And here is also showing the contour, like the line contour, which is actually showing the high density water. And this black contour is showing the lowest density water. So the density and the temperature is actually go very well. Okay? Of course, in ocean, you have another component that called salinity. They also control the density, but the sea surface density and sea surface temperature, they are very correlated. So what that says if its ocean surface is colder, it creates high density fluid, okay? Because temperature and density is inversely proportional. So if you create a high density fluid, what do you expect? You expect that water parcel will sink. It's like a natural convection. And if you create low density fluid, so they will be forming a stable boundary layer. So they will be just floating the ocean surface. Let's see this cooling and heating, how this drives overturning and as well as gyro circulation. So the whole, this hypothesis based on the buoyancy, and this buoyancy is controlled by the temperature and salinity. Of course, in an ocean surface, there is another bigger player, or you call as a bigger input of energy is there, that called wind, because atmospheric wind blowing over the ocean surface. Okay? So there is in the oceanography, the effect of wind and buoyancy is a very hot and debated topic. Who is driving the circulation? Let's move further. Now let's find out the zone where you expect to have a convection, more zooming view. So here I'm zooming the basin called Atlantic basin. Of course, you might think about in the Pacific or Indian Ocean, but if you look at very carefully our global map, Indian Ocean doesn't extend to the all the way to the North Pole. It has an extent to the South Pole. So you might think about South Pole has, there's a potential high density fluid can create it. But if the North Atlantic is such an interesting basin, you actually have it's very much symmetric. It has a cold, North Pole, and also it has a cold South Pole. So here is showing two typical sections of Atlantic. The top one is the North Atlantic, and bottom one is called South Atlantic. And I'll come back to the South Atlantic later, but let's focus on the North Atlantic. So these are again showing more schematic view of circulation. You can see this is forming this gyre circulation. That is, I told you, the biggest eddy as of it is the size of the ocean basin. And this associated by this strong western current, okay, we call as a western boundary current. Okay? And this is one of the another famous current. This western boundary current, when separates from the coast, it forms as a Gulf Stream. And this Gulf Stream goes all the way to the north. And then the sea surface temperature over this Greenland area is so cold, this current or the water mass is getting colder, so it is getting heavier, and then this start to sink. Okay, so these are the circular patches I shown it here. This is the area where it goes to open ocean convection. Okay, it's similar like a natural convection, but in ocean, because of the rotation, so is the rotation also playing a big role there? Okay, so I'll talk about in detail. So now this water sink, and then come back. Can you see in the blue line? It come back back to the equator at a greater depth. So you can think there is a horizontal circulation and as well as a vertical circulation going on. So water actually sink and coming back. Now look at in the other part of the ocean. It's called South Atlantic. And it has another interesting component called ACC. ACC is called Southern Ocean or Antarctic Circumpolar Current. You have seen the around the Antarctica, there is no continental blockage. So the ocean is moving round and round Antarctica. And in there, when you are close to the Antarctica, there is a lot of pocket. Okay, you get an open ocean convection. So water mass get denser and again go to the deeper ocean and forming another interesting overturning circulation called Antarctic bottom water. Okay. So I don't want to go to the details, but here is just to show the potential. There is a high potential of open ocean convection or convection itself in the polar regime. And it is very clear in Atlantic at both North and South Pole. For Indian Ocean, you only can see in the South Pole. For historical reason, it is only possible in the South. So it doesn't have the bottom water formation in the North for a specific. So North Atlantic is one of the nice area where you have the formation of convection or denser water at the both end.
Okay, Vishak, I want to ask short questions.
Yep.
Two of them. So in the northern hemisphere, the blue, how will the cold water come up? You said cold water comes up near South America. How can cold come up? I mean, is there some heating which happens? Yes.
Oh, no. It's not coming up. It's actually going towards the equator. It is. So I'll talk about this thing. Okay. So they're coming up actually to the surface because you have to close the circulation, right? If it's something go down, something need to come up. Okay. Right. So usually they come up location and different area. So the major portion is coming up happen in the Southern Ocean.
Okay. I see.
Okay. So we call it upwelling. Okay.
I see.
But major part of the ocean basin, they have like a very slow upwelling happen.
Okay.
We'll talk about actually. I have a nice movie. You can see like how the things are coming up.
Okay. So another short question. Like normally we have cyclonic wind, cyclonic currents in the northern hemisphere.
Yeah.
But is there? I mean, it is kind of doesn't look cyclonic. The red one, the hot one, is it there because of high pressure in the middle, or is there some comment you could like to make?
Okay. So this. I'll get back to this, okay? Because this whole gyre thing, this is what we call as a gyre, and this is called anticyclonic gyre.
Okay?
It's formed in the It is always formed in the subtropical. This is called subtropical gyres, okay? And this subtropical gyre is very symmetric. It happens in the north and it's happened in the south. You can see in the south, is also forming is. It is called cyclonic, and this is anticyclonic. Okay, so theory in the oceanography is like for last 50 years, these gyres are driven by the wind only. So it doesn't do it with the buoyancy. Okay, doesn't link with anything. Is the overturning?
Okay?
Is the water mass in one system? Okay, so a circulation in the top and circulation in the vertical, they should be connected. Okay, and at the end of this talk, I can prove like these gyres or overturning typically can be driven by the buoyancy, okay, or driven by the convection, okay. Of course, the both is a big player because wind is driving the gyre for a long period of time, okay, which like is from the literature, but the overturning is always driven by the buoyancy because because the convection is pulling the water to the bottom depth and then is coming up. Okay, this coming up theories is people have proposed by the wind, but I think it's after a couple of slides you'll see like this coming up is don't need a wind to come up the water.
service. Okay, please go on. I just want, okay, please go on.
So this is the bigger picture. So I actually already talked about this one. Okay, I mean much what is called zooming the view, and you can see is the ocean basin is very complicated. Okay, it is not only complication because of what is called much vast domain, but you can see is a complication because of the topography also. So topography also play a big role in ocean circulation. You can see this is not like a something rectangular domain. Okay, it is very very like a curvier domains, and then there is a lot of inflow outflow. There's a lot of river is coming and putting fresh water into the ocean. Okay, so there's a lot. So ocean actually very complicated system. Okay. And also like Antarctica, so there's a call like a, what is called, you have a continuously have a sea ice formation, and then at the same time you have a melting. So the fresh water actually playing a big role around Antarctica. Okay. So the, and also in the equator also you have a evaporation and precipitation. So the salinity is also playing a big role, but let's we talk about in terms of buoyancy, makes our life easy. So this buoyancy is, doesn't matter how you get it, but this is the buoyancy is a combination of temperature and salinity. Now the knowledge gap. The role of wind and buoyancy in the ocean circulation is still unclear and not quantified. Because you can see here, there is a, people are saying the overturning is caused by the buoyancy, but not the gyre. Okay. But some people are saying overturning is not fully controlled by the buoyancy. So can we identify like how much is controlled by wind and buoyancy? And one of the biggest gap in the oceanography is the role of convection is absolutely under predicted and not well represented in oceanography. Okay, convection is a big in the atmospheric science, but convection is not that well represented in ocean. So if his convection is not properly presented in ocean, then it actually we don't know his role in ocean and further in the what is called the climate change scenario. So now, I think probably you have seen before, like why this topic is so vast and difficult to understand, the length, what is called the scales, both in the time and both in the spatial. If you look down from the top, okay, so that is the scale of the domain size, okay, something like 10,000 kilometer. Okay, from north to south pole, okay, and which is having a overturning circulation, okay, and time scale is 100 years to 200 years. Okay, of course there's a much more bigger scales are there called Milenkovitch time scale. We are not that much of interested there, but I'll start with from thermohaline circulation, and then they talk about wind driven circulation, the gyre circulation, which is around the length of what is called east to west boundary, like a 5,000 kilometer, and time scale, typical time scales are 10 years. Then you have a El Nino, then you have a mesoscale eddies, okay? And they are very, very, very important eddies in terms of transferring mass and heat. And then there's a tides, tsunami, internal waves. This is another fascinating phenomena in ocean, because oceans are stratified. So you get internal waves, but and their scales are around 0.1 to 100 kilometers. Then it comes to surface waves. But if you look further, where actually you get convection or turbulence, there in terms of millimeter to centimeter and 100th to 1/10th second, you can see there is a, like a huge range of scales, okay? And the very important thing, this convection and turbulence is the smallest block or smallest Lego piece for this big puzzle. Okay? So how well you represent this turbulence and convection in the ocean, it is a very important factor. How good is the, all the, what is called, you know the whole system. An interesting part is the ocean model is only work up to the internal waves, okay, the large scale ocean models. So their turbulence are parameterized. in our case, we like to resolve the turbulence and convection well and scale up the problem. So we start from this line and try to go up. And all the oceanographic or climate model, the challenge is how far they can go to the down to the turbulence. Okay, so this is a, so that means these two studies actually is very much complement rather than competition. Now, just to restate again, why we need this type of study. Okay? You know, observations is a very difficult, this ocean is so vast. Okay? And particularly, the observations are very difficult where actually you get convection, okay, to the north and south, particularly to the south, because convection happened underneath the sea ice. So there's a very difficult, actually, you put some sensor, okay, and measure it, okay, the amount air, or do anything, or it has a lacks both spatial and temporal resolution. And the large scale model, take care of the whole global circulation, okay, cannot resolve 10 kilometer. Okay. This is like if the present date, like the highest, the resolution they can go. At the same time, they're resolving the entire ocean basin. Of course, you can do smaller, those tall is like a, it's called regional ocean model. There you can actually go the smallest scale is much smaller, but it's not as small as you can faithfully resolve convection or turbulence. Okay. So that means we need some alternative approach. So what is this approach is? It's an approach based on the dynamical regime argument. Okay. So in terms of, we can call it kind of a GFD approach. Okay. So we don't prescribe or don't think this is actually two dimension. We think about everything in a non-dimensional fashion, okay, called Rayleigh number. What are the important non-dimensional numbers are? Rayleigh number, Grassof number, Reynolds number, Rossby number, and depending on the different scenario, which numbers are playing a big role. Okay? And why is, back to again, why is it difficult? Yes, some of these numbers are really large in the ocean. Okay? Say for Rayleigh number, for ocean, the numbers are actually range of 10 to the power 20 to 10 to the power 25. Okay? Reynolds number is also very huge. Okay? Rossby number is not that bad. Okay? And aspect ratio. This is another biggest difficulty is actually modeling the ocean. So ocean actually is just a piece of paper. Okay? So this aspect ratio is the vertical length divided by horizontal. So a typical ocean vertical length is 4 to 5 kilometers. Okay. This is 5 kilometers is max actually. And then the basin scale is 5,000 to 10,000 kilometers. So that give you aspect ratio 10 to the power minus 4. Okay. So to resolve that thin piece of water, and at the same time, the importance of the vertical motion is a big challenge. So what do we do? We develop theoretical scaling and we conduct LES, DNS, and laboratory experiment. We test those scaling. Okay? And then we predict or relate some of the observation. So prediction is another very important factor, because based on this prediction, we can actually predict also polar melting. Okay? But I'm not talking about this in my talk.
Okay, one more question I'll ask. Yes. Maybe it will also interest the other audience members. So 10 for 20. So what is hot? The bottom of the ocean is hot and the top is cold. I mean, how do you compute the length scale, vertical height, D, where to where?
Okay, I'll come back to the next slide. How is the Rayleigh number is defined? This is not the Rayleigh number we defined in the Rayleigh-Bennard convection. Okay, this is a very different way of defining the element, but they're not, it's like physically they're actually very similar. Okay, so that's why my next slide is the Rayleigh-Bennard convection slide. So now I think most of the audience know about Rayleigh-Bennard convection. Okay, so what is the Rayleigh-Bennard convection? I don't have to say in detail. It's just like cooling and heating is applied at the top and bottom boundary. Okay, so it's called destabilizing condition has been given for buoyancy space in a from the both boundary. And definitely, if and they are characterized by the three important non-dimensional parameters. And the most important parameter is the Rayleigh number. That Rayleigh number can be flux Rayleigh number or can be temperature Rayleigh number. Flux means instead of you are imposing the temperature or imposing the buoyancy, you are actually imposing the buoyancy flux or temperature flux. So then it's called as a flux Rayleigh number. But both has a similar significance. It's called significance. Then another call is a Prandtl number. And then, of course, people have recently found the important non-dimensional parameters include the aspect ratio. But I like to highlight here the Rayleigh, what is called the Rayleigh number is a key parameter which actually talking about what is called the unstable buoyancy component. And the net heat flux, this system can reach thermal equilibrium state, okay, when there's a temperature inside at any depth is become steady state. And in terms of heat flux, the heat is coming from the bottom should match with the heat is coming out from the top. Okay. So there is always a net heat transferred at any vertical level. This is a very interesting fact about Rayleigh Banach. And maybe this in the community, this is well known. But now think about ocean. You looked at my first slide there. In the ocean, the SST, the soft top surface temperature. You have seen that all the temperature is applied or all the fluxes is applied at the top of the ocean. Bottom of the ocean, do you think any fluxes are coming out from the ocean? Yes, they have some fluxes called geothermal heating, but they're very negligible compared to the flux coming from the top surface. So effectively speaking, that case is almost like cooling and heating at the same horizontal level. Okay? So it's a very, very different configuration compared to Rayleigh-Banach convection. And in here, the define of the Rayleigh number based on the length scale where the heating and cooling is applied. Okay. So it is based on the L, horizontal length scale. Okay. Some people use to put vertical length scale, but vertical length scale has no what is called no physical significance. Okay. Because in Rayleigh-Banach that is they have a physical significance using the vertical length scale. But horizontal length scale for ocean where is the heating and cooling is applied is a more significant. And that's the reason the Rayleigh number is very large because of the large length scale, not because of the large delta T, because delta T is like a temperature difference across the pole to equator, and that was is not more than 20 to 30 degree max. Now the key things is here there is a no net buoyancy flux at any horizon at any vertical level. So if it's reaching a thermal equilibrium, there will be no heat. Okay, if you average it at any vertical level, there is no heat is coming from top to bottom. Okay? So this will give a big paradox. Does this support overturning at all or not? Because you know Rayleigh-Banach convection, the heat has to go from the top to bottom. So there has to be flow from top to bottom. So you have a big circulation. But in this scenario, really possible to driving a full depth circulation. Okay. So this is the bigger paradox in oceanography. So, and this is called as by just, this is not like a true, you should not go with the true naming of this system. We call as a horizontal convection. Okay. So the only is using horizontal because of course, in this system, you can get a vertical convection, but because of the forcing is like that, we call it a horizontal convection. So this is one of the simplified model of ocean. And we need to think about, is this model is sufficient to describe ocean circulation? Now, before going to the details, okay, we actually like to just keep it off track. Okay, I don't want to go to the details of this one. Well, available potential energy. Okay. not the potential energy. So what do you mean by available potential energy? This is the energy is similar to potential energy, but available means this is the energy is available for a conversion. Because, you know, in a dynamical system, you have these two reservoirs. One is the potential energy reservoir, another kinetic energy reservoir. And if it's energy transfer from kinetic to potential, then you get a motion. Okay. So this potential energy we are talking about is called available, which is available for a conversion. So let's play this movie quickly. So what is here? This is the black color thing is a block, and then rest is the water. And the top is everywhere density is same. And in this picture, the density by this yellow is lower by delta T, by delta rho. And then the density of the blue color is higher by delta T. So if you calculate the potential energy for these two systems, they're identical. Okay? But when you actually release the gate, you see the top one hardly have any motion. They have something, but that is just because of the motion is related to the moving of the plate. But if you look at the bottom one, you can see the dense water actually going down. Okay? And then the light water actually occupies the top layer. So you can see the dense water has a tendency to go down, even the both system has the same potential energy. So that is the concept of the available potential energy. And more actually in the mathematic or more like what is called in a schematic way, this is the system, okay, system one and system two. If you calculate the potential energy, they are identical, but if you calculate their available potential energy, this system has an available potential, but this system not. So how you calculate the available potential energy? Okay, so I don't want to go to details. This is the same as the vertical coordinate, but it's called modified vertical coordinate. So you have to resort this fluid parcel adiabatically, okay, to a stable state. And that is where you can extract the available potential energy. And this is the principle is applied for ocean circulation. Okay? So heating and cooling at the top surfaces in the equilibrium, there is no net heat transfer in the vertical level that still have significant amount of available potential energy to push the denser water at the pole to the bottom of the ocean and the recirculation happens. Okay, so we started with a very, very simple scenario. And for some reason, I couldn't manage to play this movie. Okay. So what is, I'm showing it here. This is absolutely a rectangle, the most simplified base ocean you can think of. Okay, so you don't go to the most complex ocean. This is the most simplified version. And of course, this is also not pole to pole. This is just, you can think as out north pole to equator. Okay? And over the equator, you are heating it. And over the pole, you are cooling it. And we define a Rayleigh number that is 10 to the power 12. Okay, I'll talk about this thing in a couple of slides. Why is this Rayleigh number is large enough or small enough or what do you mean by this Rayleigh number? It doesn't make any sense. Can you compare with the ocean scenario or not? And of course, Prandtl number is 5 and aspect ratio, as I mentioned about, still is a big challenge to go to the ocean. Okay. And the aspect ratio we maintained is a small. And the key parameters are here. Again, restating Rayleigh number, Prandtl number and aspect ratio. When you're cooling it, it is not same as Rayleigh-Benard convection. You don't expect that the plume will appear and go all the way to the bottom of the plate or bottom of the container. So what it does, it is form the small scale plume, but looks like they capped, okay? And they accumulated at the end wall and then sink. So there is a phenomena is called end wall convection or end wall net mass transport. Okay. So what is this capping it? So this is capping caused by the stable fluid, because when you're cooling and heating at the top surfaces, it creates a pressure gradient. So it creates a low pressure system over the cooler part, under this cooler part, and the high pressure, and water goes from high pressure to low pressure. And when this water goes, you can think about, because it's heating. So heating means this is less density fluid. So the less density fluid is going to the left. So if it's less density fluid, then they're actually inhibiting the convection. And it is giving a kind of stratified, sealed. Okay? So convection is varied. So the small scale plume cannot penetrate this stable layer. So what will happen? They accumulate, but at the same time, they're advected by the current and go to the end wall. And finally, they manage to penetrate this stable layer and go to the all the way to the end wall. Now, if they go to the end wall, and we found they actually go to the full depth. So if the heating and cooling supports this horizontal motion, right to left, and then vertical motion from top to bottom, then somebody has to come back. Okay. This is a very, very slow process, the coming back. And this is a very broader flow. Okay. So their magnitude is like 100 times or even 1,000 times smaller than the convective downward motion. So we call it a very broad and very slow moving upwelling. So you can see, you actually start to driving this overturning circulation by just simply cooling and heating. It doesn't require, I don't want to, what is called, too much go. It doesn't require a wind force here, okay? Or any surface stress given by the atmosphere. Okay? Just simple cooling and heating. Okay, so now, to check this one, we also conducted experiment. Okay? Because sometimes we happen like maybe the numerical, what is called, because there's so much artifact, we are numerical, we want to test it in the lab. So we tested in the lab this scenario, and we put dye here. You can see here, the dye, the blue dye is forming these small scale plumes, but they are not penetrating the full depth, except at the end wall, they're going. And then there's a recirculation happening. Of course, to get 10 to the power 12 Rayleigh number in experiment, you have to have a tank size is something 1.5 meter. Okay? And if you want to conduct experiment much bigger Rayleigh number, that means you have to have a larger tank size, like in terms of length. And there's a problem of heat loss, because you know ocean only heat transfer happen over the top surface. So rest of the side wall or bottom wall, you have adiabatic condition. So to perform this experiment is a big challenge actually. But in numerical, you can do anything you want. So for numerically, and with the help of large eddy simulation, you can actually go much larger Rayleigh number. So we did really large 10 to the power 15. So that is a large so far for this system. And that flow is much more dynamic, you can see. Okay? It has a lot of pulses, and sometimes it forms this small scale plume even over the colder part and actually sink to the full depth. And this is very, very dynamic system at really large Rayleigh number. And think about when you are considering Rayleigh number 10 to the power 20 or 25. So you might see is a very, very rigorous convection or rigorous flow. And in this system, actually, we have seen also shear instabilities. So I don't want to go to detail there. Just to tell you, yes, we managed to managed to explain or managed to demonstrate the overturning circulation in a simple fashion.
Can now, I ask a question?
Yes.
Yes. So in the experiment, actually, you do find a purple color. So does it have a significance to the upwelling, or is it
Oh yes, so this purple color actually, yes, purple color, what we did here, we actually injected in the middle. Okay, so we have seen there's two things we found in the purple color. One thing is there is called entrainment, because when the vertical plume is going down, it entrains the water from the interior. So this one actually goes inside the plume and changes the property of the convective water. At the same time, plume is also going very slow moving in the up. So
the purple one is injected at the bottom, I see. Is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Mainly the bottom. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That how this cooling and heating, you know, the cooling and heating for the experiment, is it gradual from the, you know, right to left?
No, it is. Okay. So it is, you can think of as a kind of a tan hyperbolic profile.
Okay, so how this is achieved experimentally?
Experimentally, actually, this picture, I have actually put it upside down. So it is usually achieved by heating and cooling from the bottom rather than heating cooling of the top surface. Because okay. In experiment, there's a high chance you are forming the bubbles and everything. So this is the reason, like, experiment is never conducted heating and cooling of the top surface. It's always a heating and the bottom surface. So we use a heat mat.
Okay, okay, okay. Yeah, thank you.
So experiment is a big, actually really big challenge actually to achieve large Rayleigh number. Of course, experiment recently there was a group in what is called North Carolina. So they're actually trying to conduct this experiment by salt. Okay. And they have a big challenge also with the salt, because when you're adding the salt, you're actually increasing the mass. So you have to deal with the conservation of mass. Okay. But using the salt, you can actually achieve large Rayleigh number from the same tank size. So you actually increase the Rayleigh number by another two orders of magnitude higher. So that was the reason, like people really like to do this experiment by the salt. So when you do by the salt, then you can actually pour this fresh water from the top surface. Don't have to do with the bottom surface. So those experiments is done forcing from the top. So now let's go back to the scaling, like, because that way you can extrapolate this thing. So if you think about, of course, this is a three-dimensional system, but you can always think about, because this mean flow is happening in a two-dimensional plane, so there's no harm to use a stream two-dimensional stream function and think this problem. So if you look at the momentum equation, it has three terms. One is the inertia, buoyancy, and viscous term. And if you look at the heat equation, it is only two terms, always is advection and diffusion. So now, of course, like Rayleigh-Benard system, horizontal convection can be laminar, can be turbulent. Okay? So if it's a laminar, the inertia terms are not important. So the two terms is balance each other. Of course, the source term is here is the buoyancy, to balance between buoyancy and inertia, and heat. You cannot neglect any term. Okay, so this is advection diffusion balance. So if you do further algebra, you get a scaling of boundary layer thickness, what is called the boundary layer flow, and the Nusselt number, because Nusselt number is nothing but inversely proportional to the delta. So what is the delta we talks about here? The delta we talks about is the stable part of the boundary layer thickness. So this problem was what is called proposed in 1965 by Rossby, the famous oceanographer. But all his experiment or numerical simulation is done in the regime called laminar regime. So a lot of oceanographers actually criticize his experiment or everything because they are in the laminar. So people are saying, like, okay, this system cannot drive turbulent, okay? Because first it doesn't have a net heat transfer. Okay? So that is the kind of like motivates for me actually to restudy this problem at large Rayleigh number, where actually you have three dimensionality and turbulent convection. Okay? So this scaling is well validated in the numerical simulation by Rossby or by experiment. Okay. Now, let's move further. because we interested in the large Rayleigh number. Of course, when you have a large Rayleigh number, the viscous terms is not important. There's a balance between inertia, buoyancy. Just mind the checking with the time, like a, what is the time? Is it a middle of the park or I'm almost crossing the middle?
It's okay. 20 minutes. Yeah, 20 minutes.
Okay, so a little bit rust. Okay. So now is the inertia and buoyancy balance. Okay, because you don't have a viscous. And then, of course, heat equation, I can't ignore anything. It will be back again. Advection. Advection means there is a heat is coming from the right side. That means where you're heating applied and going to the cooler end. And then diffusion of the heat is happening from the cooler end because there's a no motion there. So heat is actually vertically diffused there. So with this scaling, you get back to what is called boundless scaling, velocity and Nusselt number. You have seen the power law has not been changed, except there's a product between Rayleigh number and Prandtl number. So if it's a product between Rayleigh number, Prandtl number, always you never get the viscosity there. Okay. So viscosity is there in both Prandtl and Rayleigh number, but the product doesn't have. So the scaling is kind of very robust. Okay. Let's see, we can have any other, what is called, how valid this scaling is. So we ran series of Rayleigh number of this system, and we call as a low Rayleigh number, where is something like low means we found a cutoff at 10 to the power 10 system is actually called laminar. Of course, this 10 to the power 10 is you can be compared with Rayleigh-Bennard convection 10 to the power 6 or 10 to the power 5. Okay, so that's why saying is, and that is also depends on the boundary layer thickness, okay, not the depth, because the boundary layer thickness across that is an unstable scenario is happened. Okay? And we need to compare between the boundary layer thickness and the horizontal length scale. Okay? So that's why we get a 10 to the power 10 for critical Rayleigh number for horizontal convection. Okay. So without further wasting time, so what you see here, the Rossby regime called 10 to the power, what is called Rayleigh number 10 to the power 5, Rayleigh number minus 1/5 is really valid. But at large Rayleigh number, the scaling law doesn't change, but just shift. Okay, so it has a more heat transfer, and that is obvious because you have a turbulent flow, and this shift is caused, it can explain by the Prandtl number. So we actually what is called have some scaling law for large Rayleigh number, and we validate it, and we see like a flow feature. Okay, so this is your laminar. Okay, flow is very laminar, and then you have transitional, okay, and then if you go further, you have very very rigorous what is called convection happens, and we went up to 10 to the power 14. Now this is not the end of the story, because we only explained the overturning, we haven't explained anything like a horizontal motion so far. So what is missing? The missing component is the rotation. Let's see if it's a rotation is actually, can you introduce rotation to this simple system, is actually this, we can extrapolate more oceanic condition or not. As soon as you put a rotation, there's two things is very important, the side boundaries. Okay. Before that, in the new particular numerical simulation, we use periodic domain in the spanwise direction or into the my presentation and out of the presentation. For experiment, of course, you can't have a periodic condition. You have to have a closed domain. Okay? But there is a no flow. There is a no mean flow, or there is a no flow crosses from into the board or out of the board. But as soon as you put rotation, you have a choice. You can make it a periodic or you can make it a closed domain. Okay? And this is the interesting thing, actually. So both scenario is actually present in ocean. If you think about the North Atlantic, it is a closed domain because you have US and you have Europe or Africa in one side. But if you think about South Atlantic, it is a periodic domain because this is Southern Ocean actually moving round and round. So the both things is important if you want to have a side boundary or not. So, but in this talk, I just focus on the closed side boundary. So we have now closed side boundary and we have a rotation. When you have a rotation, you are going to add another factor or another parameter called Ekman number, or another thing is Ekman number. Another parameter is called Rossby number. So which is combination of Ekman number and Rayleigh number. We'll come to in the next slide. Another parameter, because we just talk about aspect ratio, that is depth divided by the length scale, but now your width is very important. Okay? So that will give you another parameter, another aspect ratio. So, and here I'm showing the stream function, and the colored is shown by the, what you call meridional velocity. Okay, in the oceanographic term, meridional velocity is from north to south, and zonal velocity, which is called from west and east or east to west, that is called zonal velocity. So what you can see here, even when you don't have a rotation, you have always seen there's a flow is going from north to south, what is called in here is equator to north, okay, without any turning. But now you can see they start to turn, okay, and this is interesting. I'll talk about in the next slide, okay, how this turning mechanism is possible. But you can see here it start to rotate. So at the same time, there's overturning happen, but most important thing, there is a three-dimensional nature of the overturning. Okay, so in the horizontal plane, the big current, okay, the buoyancy driven current, it start to move from in here from west to east. Before going to there, what is the convection now? Interesting. The Rossby number is defined by U over LF. Okay, this is also parameter to specify the rotation. So lower Rossby number means the larger rotation, and more lower, you are more close to the ocean. So I'm increasing the rotation in this axis, okay, the similar system. And what is I'm showing here? I'm showing the isosurfaces of vertical velocity. Okay, so that will actually quantify or qualify the convection. You can see here, as I mentioned last time, there's a shielding mechanism. So the convection is never penetrate over the cooling part. Always you have an end wall. But once you have a rotation there, if you look at this picture, there is no flow in over the cooling part, because flow is actually flowing as a boundary current. Okay, so the major part is actually exposed from the cooling. So this scenario is almost similar to like a Rayleigh-Benard scenario. So you get full depth called open ocean convection. Okay, and more you increase the rotation, the extent of the ocean convection is actually amplifying. And this is the feature is very common in ocean. They have seen in the north and south is the open ocean convection system. So interesting thing is here, we actually combining the convection in the north at the same time from pole to pole, what is called the model. Experiment, we did the similar experiment, because we actually put this and the bucket of water and heating and cooling and spinning. We have a nice rotating table in back in ANU, and we put the die. You can see the what is called, this is called this convective chimneys. Okay, it's very similar to North Atlantic. Of course, this is much more idealized fashion, because in North Atlantic there is a concentrated, because there is also zonal variation of cooling. Okay, but in here we don't have any zonal variation of temperature. This only thing is variation happening in the meridional direction. Now let's look at the scaling. Can we propose some scaling? Okay, so now is once you go to the rotation, and if you increase the rotation terms is very important. Okay, and there is a balance between buoyancy and rotation. Okay, we call as a geostrophic balance. And then heat equation, we have two terms, nothing can be neglected. And based on that, we get a geostrophic scaling based on the Rossby, or you can rewrite this thing in terms of Ekman. So we got what is called mass transport and the heat transfer scaling. And this zero is mentioned for the non-rotating case. Sorry for this axis is suddenly came so badly here. So now we actually look at the full map in the rotation and the Rayleigh number axis. So all my previous experiment in done in the non-rotating case, which is shown in here, in this axis is the Rayleigh number. We go up to 10 to the power 15 here. Okay? And this is my viscous regime to an inertia regime. Okay? Now, if I choose a Rayleigh number where you have a turbulent convection and then increase the rotation, then it will be inertia regime and then you get geostrophic regime. Okay? And of course, you continuously increase the rotation, then eventually your large scale will disappear. And then rotation is large enough to actually vanishes your small scale. And eventually you get a conduction regime. Okay, that is in here. Okay. Of course, ocean cannot be in the conduction regime because you have seen motion. And ocean is not purely inertia regime. It is somewhere in the geostrophic regime. So our objective should be inside this YOLO regime so that we actually see what is called like a same dynamical regime. Okay, so that is our main objective. Okay, of course, we cannot go to the Rayleigh number 10 to the power 20, 20 or 25 because we need an Ekman number is very, very small. So we can't go, but we like to keep inside there and slowly moving in this fashion. This is actually showing in the three dimension molecule, showing in the both stream function top and in the overturning and as well as in a horizontal fashion. So just start from here, like figure A, where you have very, very weak rotation. So the flow is always go from your right to left. Okay? And you can see this is overturning. Okay? Overturning has associated with the end wall. And then slow upwelling. Now I'm increasing the rotation. As soon as you increase the rotation, because of cooling and heating, it has to drive a geostrophic current or call it geostrophic zonal current because because by geostrophy, okay, the current has to flow between heating and cooling section. And this current has a two possibility. Once this go in the other side, it can blow as eastern boundary current or can be return flow. Okay. There's a two possibility. Okay. So either they can return flow or they can go this way. Okay. We'll talk about in my next slide, like how much is the return flow and how much is the eastern boundary current. So we actually start to see western boundary current, eastern boundary current, and return flow. We start to see this gyre. Of course, this first set of simulation we have only performed with the constant F. So there is no change of rotation from equator to pole. Okay, so this is another simple version of rotation. We increase the rotation, the flow is much more dynamic. And the most interesting part is your end wall plume is vanishes. Your overturning is more symmetric in nature. We looked at the scaling. They're quite robust geostrophic scaling, both is the vertical transport as well as horizontal transport. And heat transfer, they're also very nice. Okay. Of course, this is the axis is because this is a low Rossby number, whereas the rotation is important, and Rossby number is large means the rotation is not important. We are back to inertia regime. Okay, the things should not be depends on the Rossby number. That's why it's asymptotic. Okay, so rotation increases in this way. Now the most magical part. I learned to play it. So what we did further, we actually choose our domain because now we actually do just numerical simulation. We choose as a square basin, okay? More or less aspect ratio, length versus width is 1:1, similar like a North Atlantic scenario, okay? Because North Atlantic is 5,000 kilometer by 5,000 kilometer, and we applied cooling in here and heating is here. Okay? This is the same scenario, but in addition to that, we imposing called variation of rotation. Okay, so rotation is the highest in the pole and lowest in the equator. Okay. What do you see? You see the, and what is it showing here? It is showing the kinetic energy at the top or inside the boundary layer. This plane is showing the temperature, contour of the temperature, and this plane is showing the particle velocity, which is corresponds to convective motion. So this is the view, actually you can see everything. So what you see here, it is formed as a western boundary current, and then it is blowing as a zonal current, zonal geostrophic current. Because of the rotation, heating and cooling, it is has to flow in the west and east, and then you can see there's a some return flow, but most of the current actually blow as a eastern boundary current, and this current get cooled because your top surface temperature is cooler. So this current actually sink, and then it sometimes is come to the north, extreme north, and also sink. So there is a end wall, not end wall, this is called side wall, net mass transfer happen, and the rest of the cooling part you get just a vertical convection like a Rayleigh Bennett. They are not associated by any mass transfer, they're only associated by heat transfer. So what is the difference between F plane and beta plane? Because of the beta plane, you actually get or reproduce this subtropical and subpolar gyre. Okay, this is the first time evidence by buoyancy forcing can produce these two gyre is shown in here. Okay. One is called subtropical gyre, another is called subpolar gyre, okay, just by heating and cooling. One more thing, we found it because of the beta plane, there is a Rossby waves are propagating from west to east that actually amplify this current, make it the current more sharper and more intensified. So the western boundary current is actually getting more stronger. It's a more realistic western boundary we found it. And we actually also found the separation when this current actually separated from the western boundary. And so you can extrapolate this current is nothing but actually kind of like is similar to the Gulf Stream. So we speculate that this simple heating and cooling and under the rotation environment, you start to producing this gyre, okay, as well as overturning circulation. And this is my nice schematic here, how this three-dimensional nature of the circulation happens. Okay? And that is the way they're driving this gyre. I'm not sure. Okay, so we also, I think it's not playing in this movie. So we start to working on the wind. Okay, we are. Yes, I think that's some reason. So what we did here, this is ongoing work. So we putting imposing the wind. Okay. So this is the same wind profile over the North Atlantic, and wind profile is given by this blue line. And then temperature heating is the gradual. And of course, it will produce the similar thing. It will what it need to be produced. So the gyre and everything. And we found the gyre strength is a function of wind, but only the subtropical gyre, the gyre close to the equator. The subpolar gyre is insensitive to the wind forcing. And the most important part is the overturning. So wind stress is actually not playing much role driving the overturning. So it's very, very insensitive. And we start producing this scaling. So this scaling can be very, very useful to predict the heat transfer or heat uptake in the ocean. And we get this scaling law where this S is the wind stress factor. And as I mentioned before, wind also play a big role of heat transfer. It enhancing the heat transfer, okay, by this fashion. Now, I think I'm end of the talk. So what we did, we actually say that non-rotating AC can produce turbulence. So that is what is called kind of like a big paradox in oceanography that horizontal convection cannot be turbulent, but we claim it, yes, it can produce the turbulence, it can overturning. The most important part is once you have the heating and cooling is and at the same time rotation, it starts to produce the big gyre. So things like this overturning is not just overturning what oceanographers always think. It is actually happen in three-dimensional fashion as a contribution of the gyre as well as overturning. And more looking forward, yes, of course, ocean is very complex. We like to, what is called, looking at the effect of the topography. And at the same times, we like to look at the effect of the freshwater and saltwater influence, because that is a very important driving the circulation or shutting down the circulation in a climate change scenario. And these are the showing what are the other researches we do. We also are very interested in looking at the polar ice melting and also Southern Ocean circulation. I didn't have much time to talk about. We also proved that just heating and cooling in a periodic domain, it is actually driving the Southern Ocean. So the another future study will be what is called horizontal convection, connecting the north and south, driving the whole overturning by the buoyancy forces. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhishek, for excellent talk. Very colorful and excellently presented.